Welcome to Platts Commodity Pulse. I'm Richard Swann. Today we're going to take an in-depth look at what is probably the most important story for us here at Platts reporting the energy market, the price of oil. We're going to have an in-depth look at why 2011 was a record price for oil, what that actually means, and where it's going so far this year, as well as how oil links with some of the other big global markets out there. With me today in the studio to talk about this is Geoff King, our oil futures market editor. Geoff, first of all, can we maybe have a look at the price of oil so far in 2012? What have we seen out there? We're nearly 3 months in.
Okay, well, we've taken Brent here, and starting at the beginning of the year, Brent is generally considered for the moment a better indication of where the economy is. And if we look at the start of the year, we got off to a flyer. We started off with a big bounce on news that or macroeconomic data out of China and India, two of the big emerging markets, that positive, that showed that everything was good there. But following on from that in January, there's a definite downward trend. Very small downward trend, but a downward trend nonetheless. There was a couple of factors behind that. I think one of those was the Eurozone. This was balancing out Eurozone concerns, a debt crisis that was going on with Greece and other nations, was balancing out the situation in Iran and possible supply concerns there. And also supply concerns out of Iran got a bit of a help from reports that there might be a 6-month delay on EU embargo on Iranian imports in order to allow countries like Greece, Spain, Italy time to find new suppliers of Iranian oil that they were going to have to replace. If we then move on to February, what we're seeing here is a very strong upward trend. Now, you notice we've used a candlestick chart here, and the reason we've done that is to show the number of positive days in here. By positive days, I mean days that have closed higher than what they opened at, and they're reflected in the green candles. The red candles down days, but the green candles show days where we're strengthening, and we're seeing that all the way through February almost. What was driving that? Well, again, we come back to Iran. We had increased concerns over Iran and the situation there. We also had in Europe, and this affects Brent, we had an extremely cold winter spell that drove up demand for products and as a consequence drove up demand for Brent crude, as opposed to in the States where it was a very mild winter. So those two factors really helped to drive prices up, as well as indications and hopes that the Eurozone debt crisis was coming to an end, that we were finding a resolution. If we then move into March, we're now seeing what is a very flat trend. We're seeing markets here very much range bound. The trading between around $123.50 and $127 per barrel. But there are two noticeable little spells in here. If we look at the first one here, we're seeing markets strongly up and then the following day strongly down. Now, the reason behind that was what we saw was reports which seemed to be coming out of Iran that there'd been an attack on a Saudi oil pipeline. Of course, that sent fears through the market about supplies coming out of Saudi, and prices shot up. Very quickly, the Saudis came out and denied that anything had happened to any of their pipelines, denied the reports, and prices quickly fell back down. The Saudis, again, were involved in this second little patch here. We had a downward day after the Saudi cabinet came out with comments saying that they wanted to see prices at fairer levels. They would do what they could to see prices at fairer levels, throwing out a bone, I guess, or a little bit of hope that perhaps they were going to put some more production, some more crude into the market. That eased the supply concerns a little bit, and prices dropped. Now, what was interesting, the very next day, Saudi Oil Minister Ali Onaimi held a press conference in Doha where he came out and said that he saw the markets as being well supplied, prices weren't justified, but the key thing being markets were well supplied. That indicated that any hopes that came out of the previous day of perhaps the Saudis stepping in and increasing supply had just been expelled by the Onaimi's comments.
Very interesting you've picked up on these Saudi comments. Let me ask you a little bit more, particularly about Ali Naimi's comments. Now, he was quite clear that Saudi Arabia is ready to use some of its significant spare capacity if needed by the market. But right now, he thinks the market's pretty well supplied, if anything, oversupplied. Have they been increasing production recently?
If we look at the Saudi numbers, we can see that there's been a steady increase over the last year in Saudi production. We're now at around 10 million barrels per day, and as a consequence, OPEC production has also increased. Now, this 10 million barrels production that of output that Saudi's got at the moment is around the highest levels for 30 years. So they have stepped in and lifted their supply as prices have gone up. What's interesting to note, though, is how the markets are taking this. Now, first of all, as they've increased supply, you would think, okay, this is good for markets. There's more in the market. Prices should come down, and I think that's what they're aiming at. But the markets are more concerned as they've increased supply with the spare capacity. Now, as they've increased their supply, obviously Saudi being holding output. Production capacity of 12.5 million barrels per day. They've got that gap. They can raise the production, but the market is nervous that the higher they go, there's less oil to put in the market. There's nobody else out there that's got the spare capacity that they've got. And if demand continues to increase, that where is this extra oil going to come from? So what we're seeing is, yes, that the Saudis have worked in some ways to balance the market with increased supplies. The impact on prices has been very little because as the supply has risen, the focus has shifted to what about spare capacity levels.
That's interesting. The Saudis and other producers regularly blame speculators for high oil prices, and particularly in this case when the Saudi oil minister is so clearly saying fundamentally there's excess supply, pointing at sort of speculative activity in the market as being a factor behind high prices. How are we able to gauge that? How can we read that?
Okay, well, with regard to Brent, if we have a look at that, we see every week the Intercontinental Exchange puts out their commitment of traders report. And what we've seen so far this year is we're seeing non-commercial net position getting bigger to the point where it's reaching record levels. What this means is the non-commercials are fundamentally speculators. So the more speculators taking long positions, the more they think prices are going to increase. So what we're seeing now is record levels of speculation betting that we're going to see oil prices continue to rise. And if we look as a number of speculators are coming into the market, we're also seeing the price rise.
I want to ask, while you're here, I want to talk to you about the link and the spread between Brent futures and WTI futures, the two benchmark global oil contracts. A lot has been said, and we've said a lot before, about the very, very unusual inversion in this spread, where WTI used to historically trade at a premium to Brent. That's long gone, and we know a bit about that. That's the story of the last couple of years. But can you quickly talk us through this and where this might be going, more importantly?
Okay, what we've done is we've put a chart here going back to the start of January last year, showing both the WTI and Brent prices and how they've evolved. If we were to go slightly back behind that into 2000 and previous, we would have seen that traditionally WTI and Brent move very closely together. You know, occasionally Brent would trade at a small premium, occasionally WTI would be at a premium, but generally they were very close together. If we look at the start of January 2011, they're close together. There was only $2 or $3 gap there. At the time it was considered a little bit unusual. Not so much the size, but the length of time that it had held, which had been since about August of 2010. But as you can see, as we've progressed, this gap has really expanded. Now, there's a couple of factors behind this. The most obvious of them is the Arab Spring. On the 17th of December 2010, there was a Tunisian gentleman who set himself on fire in protest at government, which set off a rising of protests in the Arab world. And among those, I think the key ones, first of all, we saw Egypt. And as President Hosni Mubarak came to the end of his 30 years of power, we saw an expansion of the Brent premium to WTI. Then I think what really surprised the world was Libya. We saw in Libya, the eastern parts in Benghazi start to rise, eventually taking over, and then a very long process here of internal fighting, which, you know, Libya being an OPEC country had a major impact on markets. Now, as there were supply concerns in Europe and raising Brent levels, in the US it was the opposite scenario. In the US we were seeing stock levels building at Cushing, the delivery point for WTI in Oklahoma, and this was really helping. You've got two different fundamental factors, disconnected markets driving oil prices in opposite directions. In here, we start to see the gap narrow. Now, there's two reasons, again, for that. One is we reached an endpoint in Libya. Gaddafi's reign was over. He'd been killed, and hopes for the Libyan oil market coming back onto the market, which we're now seeing that's happening at a much faster pace than what was expected. But also, we heard about Enbridge buying out the remaining stake of in the Seaway pipeline from Conoco in the joint venture that they had. When they bought this out, they also announced plans to reverse this pipeline, so that instead of only having pipelines coming into Cushing, we now have a pipeline pushing out onto the Gulf Coast, giving WTI a new market. The consequences of this were to push WTI up on the pipeline agreement and bring Brent prices back down on the hopes that there'd be these supplies returning to the market. And so we saw the gap narrow there. Moving into the new year, we're seeing a little bit of a further separation coming on. And again, that has a lot to do with supplies in the United States, in Cushing, Oklahoma especially, being still being very high. And instead of Libya, now the situation is Iran, supply concerns with regard to Iran into Europe, pushing the price of Brent up. Having said that, we go back to the pipeline and people with June, the first 150,000 barrels per day being able to be transported through this pipeline from Cushing and onto the US Gulf Coast, we should see a narrowing again of this premium and perhaps normalcy restored.
So disconnected markets potentially becoming connected once again. That's definitely one a theme to watch out for this year. Before we go, I'd like to ask you about two other sort of interesting indices I know you watch very closely when you track the price of oil. We talk a lot about how oil tracks or doesn't track general stock market indicators. In this case, we've got the S&P 500. And after that, I'd like you to talk a little bit about the impact of Forex rates on oil as well. But first, the stocks.
Well, if you look at this, again, we've gone back to January of last year. We're comparing WTI with the S&P 500, a key index on US markets. It's around July that we started to see some sort of connection. I think the Arab Spring had sort of been priced into the market. The market was now looking at other driving factors, in particular the US economic recovery, macroeconomic factors there, which allowed the two markets, both the equities and oil, to move with a strong correlation. We saw a little bit of a breakout here in November. Again, we go back to Libya and the overthrow of Gaddafi and his regime. And at the same time, November, we're starting to see third quarter numbers coming through from the US, which perhaps weren't as positive as people had hoped. And this breakaway, again, it's since then, the market has been moving in almost, not in two different directions, but there has been a disconnection.
And do you think we get a closer correlation with the dollar index or dollar rate versus the euro perhaps than we do on the stocks?
We're seeing a very strong correlation at the start, but then a breakaway here in the middle, where from May to perhaps November.
So interestingly, at this point, as we look at 2012 then, from the perspective of a European oil importing country, your currency is struggling and the price of oil you're importing is going up at the same time.
That's an interesting dynamic that we're seeing. I mean, with the euro dropping as low as it has and with it holding in this very narrow range, much lower than what it was here, whilst at the same time oil prices continue to rise, what we're seeing is in terms of euro currency, we are now at record price levels. So with the stronger oil prices and the weaker euro, or stronger oil prices and the stronger dollar versus the euro, what we're seeing is that the oil price in terms of euro currency being at record levels.
Well, that's certainly one to look out for in the coming months if we're already at those levels. Well, Geoff, thanks very much for coming in today to talk about this in more depth. It's a much more in-depth look than we normally manage at something like the headline price of oil, although I appreciate for you it's probably not enough, but it's great for us. Thanks very much. That's all for this edition of Platts Commodity Pulse. See you next time.